studied to be a famous. Okay, thank you. So you all want to study to be like Carl Sagan. But, well, I would say that last night he was a little bit controversial in talking about is there a God or not God? Should we spend the money on the space flight or not? Should person believe those UFO? Some of you know what is UFO, unidentified flying object. Is it exists or not exists, government cover-up or not a cover-up. Should you believe in the fortune, the astrology, that every day that you look at newspaper before you do anything, that kind of thing. It's kind of interesting. He does have a point. Why the newspaper will list those, either you Scorpio or not, and you do what they doing what, and every day newspaper seems to do that, and that is so unscientific, so sloppy in the scientific things. And why only once a week they maybe will say something about science or technology? You know, our country has not really emphasized the science and the technology. Maybe in the Russia, every day you see science article, right? Huh? Oh, politics. Yeah, right now is a huge politics right now. I don't know, is that Yeltsin winning? They are going to negotiate now. Okay, I don't want to take too much tangent to our lecture. I hand out the supplement note. After I review my note, I did not include the section 6 in my part 1. That is taking the average of that equation. So I'm going to back off, and then we can talk about our order of magnitude analysis. So replace this cover to your cover, or actually if you already bind it, just write it in this couple line. and then I gave you a 3-page of those ensemble average Navier-Stokes equations. So let me kind of back off, talk about a little bit of how we decide to describe the turbulence, okay? So the section 5 on the part 1, we talk about the method of description of a turbulent flow. And we talk about statistical methods and some average way of doing it. Then I kind of just left there. Actually, I should proceed to just take a Navier-Stokes equation, ensemble average, then you see all of them together. So let me kind of just back off, kind of bring your feeling up a little bit, and then we'll take the ensemble average. So when I was talking about describing a turbulent flow, one of the way to do it is the statistical method that we talk about it. And I'm not going to be very detailed, just kind of give you a quick overview, then you know what we are doing. Statistical way is that instead of looking at any instantaneous fluctuation, you're asking for probability function distribution. So if it is the instantaneous distribution will be like that one, then you say, I understand turbulent, okay? And the reason we don't want to do that is that for every component of velocity, you have to do one probability function and at every point. And so at every point, if you have 3 component of velocity, then you have too many to do it. So we don't want to do that. So we choose to do at the earlier stage of approach, sort of like an engineering approach, is so-called Reynolds averaging. And the essential Reynolds proposed that why don't we take an instantaneous signal and just take a long time average. It's with respect to time. You take a time average, then you get an average of something looks like that. Now the Reynolds average has its, actually Reynolds contribute a lot, because just take a long time average actually do very well for many turbulent problems, unless you encounter unsteady, kind of a time dependent type of the turbulent flow, then you have that problem. Or when your time-dependent motion and the fluctuation is almost about the same frequency, then you are really in trouble, right? So for example, like a heartbeat, you beat once like this, then since the overall flow actually fluctuates with time, just like a weather in the temperature, day, like this morning is 58, and then daytime is 84, so you kind of fluctuate. But every given wind and the sun come out, you have a little bit of fluctuation in temperature, then you don't know what is the characteristic time you got to take that average. If you take a long time, one day, 24-hour average, then you don't get the 58 in the morning, 84 in the daytime. Everything just average out. So you see the Reynolds average applied to the time-dependent type of the flow, then it become a problem because you don't know what characteristic to go after. Of course, there are some experiments that is saying, gee, I know it. You give me a problem, I take a look, take a measurement, then I can decide what is the kind of time scale I got to do it to take average. For example, the hospital physician said, I know the heartbeat is 60 or 70, and all those they call heart murmur, that they can hear kind of a funny sound in there. They say, well, that is the sound frequency, so I'm going to take every 2 seconds, every something to take an average of it. So they can do that. I think the best way to do it is do an ensemble average. And that is say, not with respect to time, it's with the number of the events occur, repeated events occur, and you take an average over the number of the events, okay? So the best way to describe the heartbeat is that you continue beat, so 70 beats per minute. So you take all the 70, when the heart valve open, you call it the initial, and the take 70, sometimes we call phase average, is that you each wave, you kind of mount it on that, and you take an average of that one. So the ensemble average looks like every individual event looks similar, but not quite. So you add all of them up, and looks like a very messy one. If you take an average of those, then you get this time-dependent one out, okay? And that sort of become a filter. Filter your high-frequency fluctuation, but your overall time-dependent one, you still retain it. So that's the way we want to do our the averaging. So let's move on to this new material I gave you today. This is the average turbulence equation, and I put the parenthesis incompressible flow, as I keep saying that we got to go to the fundamental first before you jump into too complicated one. So I add a line, this is not in your note, I say take ensemble average of Navier-Stokes equation and energy equation, okay? Now how we want to do it, of course we already know it, at any given time, the star variable, P star, U I star, or T I star, or the stress that the tau I J star, we call it instantaneous. So it's containing overall time motion plus the fluctuation. So I like you to think all the capital one is a sort of overall average one, but don't think it's independent of time. It can be a dependent of time because we are going to take ensemble average, okay? And then the small character that I put down there, since the small character of T we already use for time, so to avoid the confusion, we're using a theta, so it's a kind of Greek letter for the T. So then you have a fluctuating part of it here. Both of them is a time dependent, okay? But the capital one is a slow time dependent compared with the rapid fluctuation of it. From time to time, you see some paper, they will divide into three parts. Instantaneous part, they want to divide in three parts. It's one is the average in time, one they call it the coherent turbulent fluctuation, then there is a random turbulent fluctuation. And some people will prefer to do that because they say that even in the turbulent flow, it's not a totally random fluctuation, so they want to filter out the coherent part of it. Okay, but for now, This is complicated enough for us already. We don't want to do it. But I just mentioned, in case you want to do research or you encounter some problem, you really got to filter out the so-called coherent structure in the turbulent, then you may want to do that. Okay, so now with temperature, velocity, pressure, and I shorthand it with the stress. Of course, you know the stress writing is like this. In the Cartesian tensor notation, so tau ij, it has a 9 component. We already look at it. Diagonal one will be tau ii, tau 1, tau 2, tau 3, and so forth. And then there will be shear part of it. So if you take an ensemble average, then this is the equation not on your note, but somewhere in your previous note there. Incompressible equation, of course, continuity, momentum equation, of course, it has three components, I run 1, 2, 3, and so forth. So let me. And for the energy equations, incompressible flow, if you cast it into the specific P part there, you can write the equation, looks like that. So of course, everyone knows that the left-hand side is that the time change of a momentum or time change of your energy following the fluid motion, because I'm using a capital D, which is the total derivative or the derivative following the fluid motion. Then on the right-hand side of the momentum equation is the summation of all possible force, which is the gravitational force, pressure force, and viscous force. Okay, and in the energy equation is the time rate change of energy into your fluid following the motion will be due to the molecular conductions, due to the work done by the frictions. Okay, and I take it out, the chemical heat generation out for now. So these are instantaneous one. And now if you put in all of this fluctuating component and average component there to the Navier-Stokes equation, the equation is the same. And taking the ensemble average, you are going to get this equation. Okay, now if you're looking at it, this equation essentially looks very similar to Navier-Stokes equation that has a time rate change of the momentum is equal to the summation of the force, which is the gravitational force, pressure force, and now this without the star, which is the average stress, which is written like this because all the capital is the average. In addition to that one, we get the term, we call it the tau ij with upper script T there. We call it the turbulent part of it because it looks very much like this viscous stress. So we give it a name. As I write down there, we call it the Reynolds stress because the Reynolds is the first one derive that expression there. Okay? Now, if you have an incompressible equation here, then you know you have an average continuity equation, you have an average momentum equation, and that is all you got because you just take a Navier-Stokes equation there. You have how many variables? You have a 3 velocity variable and pressure variable. Density, assume no. Temperature does not come in if you assume there's no property variation there. So you have a 4 equation, 4 unknown, plus this Reynolds stress, which is the essentially 6 term there, the diagonal side u square, v square, w square, and then you have a uv, uw, and the wv there. So you have a 6 additional unknown there, so we got to derive that equation, and that derivation we'll see that one, but I assign as a homework. I seem to always do that because for turbulent class, you go through once, then in your lifetime, you know that you did it. So anytime you're looking at the transport equation there, you feel comfortable. Now we can do the same thing for the energy equations, which is this equation we are looking at, instantaneous temperature equation there. You put the T plus fluctuation in here, and so is all the velocity there, then you come up with this energy equation here. Now, this equations, as you're looking at here, again, is the same thing, except I just write the order a little bit different. It's a time rate change of the energy in the fluid volume following the motions is equal to what contributes to that one is the frictions created by the viscous stress, because you do have a viscous stress in there. And this is done by the molecular conduction plus another one we call, looks very much like a conduction with QIT. Actually, that comes from the convections, fluctuation of the temperature contribute to the increase in the heat flux. So we give it a name there. Some people like to use that name as a Reynolds heat flux because it's kind of counterpart of a Reynolds stress, or more popularly people just call it turbulent heat flux because you have molecular heat flux versus turbulent heat flux if you wish to do that. Now again, we got a problem. If we think this equation to use to solve for temperature, of course the conduction term, molecular conduction term, we already have a Fourier law. We can relate to the temperature with the conductivity K provided by the handbook or the experimental measurement. Then we thought we have an equation. But now we got this additional unknown of an ensemble average of fluctuating velocity and fluctuating temperature, and we got a problem. So again, if you want to give a little bit of physical feeling about what this term is doing, I kind of want to use the jogging of Ken Carlson and myself running together. And I just want to run a little bit faster, but I want to give him something. For example, I just order the fried potato, which is very hot. So I have a little bit of hot. So I can't eat one, so I throw at him. So it's a fluctuate from me, go. And you catch it, your temperature goes up because fried potato is hot. So that kind of fluctuation. So if I'm running in the U component, I get a U transfer. If we are running parallel, I got to throw this way, I throw in the V. So you see you have a three component of a fluctuating heat transfer by convection. When I say throw, it's a fluid motion, move it over. It's not by the conduction. So you can see that in addition to the molecular conduction that goes through the air to your body, I can convect something to you. And so that sometimes is a very large amount. So you see typically this kind of heat flux compared with the molecular conduction can easily be 100 times, 1,000 times, 10,000 times very easily. Okay? For example, you drink a hot water and someone, your mother or father just boil too hot. What do you do? What are you doing? You try to create a turbulent to take away the heat from the surface. If you just wait there, by the molecular conduction, it's so slow, right? Or the laminar conduction. So you got to blow it. And when you blow the hot the air from your lung, you are just try to create a turbulent on the surface to take away the heat. And if you cannot wait anymore, what you do? You take something. And particularly for Chinese, when they eat those rice soup, that's too hot, they always just blow the air on the tank, create a turbulent in the liquid, so it can cool off much quicker because you can transfer the heat much, much, much easier that way. Okay, so now you know physically that one is. Now, for today's order magnitude estimate, we are going to use an equation up to here, that is to using the average momentum equations and the average energy equations in there. I would say really not enough, because you do know continuity equation, momentum equation, energy equation can only provide that equation for your average quantity. The Reynolds stress and Reynolds heat flux, you don't have a way to handle it, all right? But for order magnitude analysis, I'm going to borrow something. Okay, later on I'll talk about it. But just to finish this section, to give a closure of the number of equation versus number unknown. And of course, the number of equation we are talking about must be an independent equation so that you can have a solution. So we got to find out six Reynolds stress equation, three Reynolds heat flux equation. So now, how to derive this? Actually, I can say, okay, look at your homework, go ahead and do it. But let me just explain a little bit more here. Obviously, you know the Reynolds stress is all fluctuating variable only, okay? So is the Reynolds heat flux, everything fluctuating. So in order to derive an equation for that kind of quantity, the first thing you do is you try to find that disturbance equation. So very easily you can do it. I can write it, NS, of course, everybody knows, Navier-Stokes equation, instantaneous variable. And then you subtract the ensemble average, the equation. And, of course, you subtract out the mean. So what's left, we are going to call it the fluctuating equation. Or we are using an MI, M for momentum. I is a particular I component of it. Okay, that versus the average equation I put here as a capital MI, that is a mean quantity, and with subscript I component there. So that every time I call it the small MI, then you know what equation I'm talking about. Okay. The same things, you can have an energy equation, instantaneous, subtract the ensemble average equation, then we are going to call it the theta equation or the disturbance temperature equation, or just denote as a theta. Okay? So now we already established the equation that govern all the fluctuating behavior. As a matter of fact, we already seen that one in the Osamoff equation and so forth. But this time, you don't drop anything out. Remember when we talk about infinitesimal in the stability equation, because you call it the infinitesimal, the nonlinear term, you can throw them out. If a nonlinear term throw out, all the Reynolds stress gets thrown out, right? So Reynolds heat flux gets thrown out. So you don't throw them out, and you want to keep everything here. And now, how to get the equation for these two variables we talk about, Reynolds stress and Reynolds heat flux? Since you know there is a product here, this also has a product of a velocity and the temperature fluctuation. So what you have to do is to look at manipulations. I'm just going to touch a little bit. Take a momentum I equation. Let me amplify this part here. Take the fluctuating momentum I equations times the UJ equation. So that means one I component versus the other component. Okay. Now, if I and J turn out to be the same, then you know it's the same direction. Okay. But in general, we want the Reynolds stress for IJ, right? So we want to have a two equations. Now, but you have to do it by plusing another M momentum equation in the J direction times the UI velocity, and then put them together. And then, should I use the American word, lo and behold, now you got this messy equation there, all right? And it is for you to go and verify once. This equation is not too bad. I think you most of you can do it. Then in the homework, I said that we need to fluctuate. We got a term there which is very messy here. We are going to call dissipation. So I'm going to ask you to also go and derive that equation, which is the epsilon equation here. Okay? This is going to be a little bit messy, take you a little bit. So I say drink a lot of coffee before you you derive it, or do it in the morning so you won't get to follow that much. But I did it once. I hope my typing here has no mistyping of a suffix there, but if you do find it, let me know. Okay, then if this Reynolds transport equations, this is called Reynolds stress equation if you like, has a UI, UJ. This is the total derivative and has the messy of this one. I will leave that one out for now. When I come back to talk about the modeling the equation, I'll tell you more detail what each term physically is doing later. But for now, if I and J become the same, then you are talking about the II, UI, UI, by Cartesian tensor notation, if you have a repeated subscript, you do the summation of I equal 1, I equal 2, I equal 3. So by taking the I equal j divided by 2, then you get this equation. Taking the ui here, making I equal j divided by 2, then you have a u squared plus v squared plus w squared divided by 2, then you know it looks like a Bernoulli quantity that you learn in undergraduate class, but this time is for fluctuating part of it here, so we are going to call it the turbulent kinetic energy K. Okay? Now, using a K prime is that before I take the ensemble average, using the K without the prime there, which is I already taking the ensemble average. So you get that equation, okay? This equation is very easy to get. All you have to do is take this equation, make I equal J, and just clean up the notation. You should get it, all right? So in the homework, I want you to try the Reynolds stress equation and the dissipation equation there. Also in the homework, looks like I'm a bad guy assigning too much homework to you, but anyway, when you get to use it, then you say, Professor Chen is a good guy that you already understand. For the Reynolds heat flux, what you have to do, let me amplify here, a little bit different. You take one momentum equation, fluctuating equation times the temperature, then you take the energy fluctuating equation times the velocity quantity, and then add them up in the ensemble average, then you'll be able to get this, the Reynolds heat flux, okay? We'll talk about that one. I think we will be working with them, these equations for a long time, because these are equations engineers like to use most, because obviously you can derive more complicated higher order equation there, or make it even simpler. But today's engineer, 20th century or the latter part of 20th century engineer, I bet you the 21st century, the first part of engineer, probably got to deal with this equation a lot. Okay? Maybe the direct numerical simulation will become available, but if we just got to wait and see how fast the computer technology will come, then we can turn into direct numerical simulation. Otherwise, I will assume before I retire, this equation will still be very much in demand. So, okay, so with that is available, now we can go back and visit our part three. The part two, of course, is the transition you already gone through here. And now it's kind of back to review a little bit the order of magnitude estimate. I'm using an estimate so that I won't give you an idea that we are doing a very accurate, precise one. But the estimate, you must base on something. If I say the order of magnitude guess, or I say order of magnitude fortune tale, then you know it. You just go there and just randomly draw one answer out of it. So when you say estimate, you really got to have some idea how you are going to go do about it. OK, so let's looking at what we talked about the last time. Order of magnitude estimate, and right now, we can try to estimate. As a matter of fact, I have a variety note written. You can estimate the jet spreading. You can estimate the mixing layer. You can estimate the wake and so forth. But I think for engineer, most important one is the interaction between the fluid and the solid body. We have a solid body here. The heart goes through your heart, blood goes through your heart, actually interaction between the fluid and the solid, turbine, car, bicycle, airplane, everything you're looking at has that interaction. So we want to estimate what happened the turbulent close to a solid wall, okay? And so, of course, the simplest one is looking at the two-dimensional incompressible and flow of a turbulent goes through some kind of surface there. Okay, before I pose this question again, we have seen this picture, but let's just look at that one more time here. This is the flow visualizations of a flow near a curved body like a sphere, okay? And the top part you are looking at here, which is laminar flow, the bottom part is turbulent flow. Now, I assume in your viscous flow or intermediate flow, you learn enough to understand what is going on in the boundary layer of a laminar flow, or even at the point of a separation, so how you do it and so forth, have some understanding. Now, since we are in the turbulent class, so we are questioning what is going on in this inside this turbulent boundary layer. What make it a ripple here, what make it the thickness like this, and of course eventually we said why the turbulent separation will delay so much compared with that. Okay? Another view you can look at is, again, this is a boundary layer, laminar flow at the lower Reynolds number. When it becomes turbulent, you can see the thickness almost triple. And you can see all kind of the wave or the eddy show up there. Okay? So that is something we want to estimate before we really jump into all the correlation and so forth. So last time I used this one to show a little bit more inside view of what is happening inside that turbulent boundary layer. And I think this actually tell quite a bit of it, because you know outside the boundary layer, almost no fluctuation. Of course, at the wall, no fluctuation, unless you want the wall also to vibrate. So then you know that fluctuation seems to be quite a bit very close here, but you still have a fluctuation here, but not so much. So right away, if you just imagine you summing U square, V square, W square, right away intuitively you are going to say here seems to be large, right? Seems to be large. So obviously you see it here if in terms of a K. Now we can talk about U square, V square, W square divided by 2. K will be almost zero up here. K is zero on the wall. Somewhere in between, got to have a maximum. If there are going to be a 2 maximum, you can argue about it, but experiments show for this kind of boundary layer, normally is 1. If it is a, you are in the channel flow here, I have a wall here, I have a wall here, then of course I know K will be 0, K will be 0, then you know turbulence is going on there. But the K is always positive, definite, because everything is square. So got to be always positive, but between the channel, you do have a 2 maximum, because why? Near this wall, you have a shear layer. Near this wall, you have a large shear. So you have a 1 maximum, another maximum. Because near the center, profile kind of flattened out. Then you cannot sustain the nonlinear interaction of all the turbulent generations. So you can guess that. So by use whatever the intuition, I think perhaps most of us agree that the perhaps one maximum in there. And indeed, actually, experiment showed that. So. At least from that observation, we know, looks like that. So now our question is that, is there some way, not the quick and dirty, a quick and clean way of guessing how thick it is going to be, where this maximum turbulent fluctuation looks like it is going to locate, and if there is a turbulent boundary layer going to grow like this, is this outside the boundary layer growth, like talking about here, is this outside growing and the inside this maximum growing at the same rate? Looks like it's very logical, because in your laminar flow you have a Blasius profile, and you know Blasius profile is similar, and so you can pile it up by just stretching one scale, everything falls into one place. But the turbulent, actually you can go ask many people doing a turbulent research or doing turbulent modeling or anything, you can ask them that how this maximum fluctuating growing and versus the outside boundary layer. Many people cannot answer it. Even my advisor couldn't tell me until I begin to question. So I kind of tell the far downstream story first to you. Why I begin to interest in this one. You study later on, maybe some of you already heard, there is a so-called inner law. There is a turbulent fluctuations, they call inner law. There is a law governing the inside layer. There is an outer law, there's an outside law governing it. So when I was studying it, I said, why? In my laminar flow study of boundary layer, never anyone tell me I got to study the inner boundary layer and then to study the outside outer boundary layer, still within the boundary layer outer. Then the why in the turbulent, I need that. And I ask everybody, and they say, no, it's been always this way. You just got to study inner law, outer law. That is it. All right? Now we are going to find out why it's a necessity of that one by order of magnitude analysis later on. And probably that kind of information, maybe in another book, actually it's there, but nobody kind of explained in a logical way for you to understand why we need a two law to describe a turbulent boundary layer. All right? So it's very interesting. For example, many of you know how to solve laminar flow by similarity transformation. Everybody can do a similarity transformation, right? If I give you a turbulent boundary layer equation, I say solve by similarity transformation, till you graduate, you cannot give me an answer because there is no similarity transformation available for turbulent boundary layer. Now, many of people just stop there. Now, if you step another one to ask why the turbulent boundary layer don't have a similarity solution, that is what we try to explain in the following here, okay? So at least for now, we can agree that looking at the picture, experiment looks like there is a maximum fluctuation there. So let me give you just a qualitative throw. The outside K will be zero, inside K will be zero. Somewhere I have a profile like that, okay? And the reason I draw the inside there seems to be thinner than that one is probably basically you can say, well, you just look at this picture, you seem to know it, probably large fluctuation will be here, and the boundary layer go all the way out there. So I kind of just qualitatively draw it. Now, you may also wonder, is there any way you can make a quick estimate, tell me how thick the inside layer versus the outer, the whole layer is? I say, well, we have a way of estimating it, all right? So, okay, now, to solve this equation, I said estimate, not just a fortune teller or just guessing it. So to estimate, we got to have some base. And you know it, as last time I already said, all our Fourier phenomenon is governed by Navier-Stokes equation. So after you take ensemble average, it's still there, right? So you got to go and dig it out from there. Then the point is that how you dig it. And I already, at the end of the last class, I said, do you wish to solve 3D unsteady? You say, no. I said, how about just a 3D steady? You say, yeah, kind of slow. There, or tinker with your nose. You wish the genie come to help you, and you can solve in there. So then I say, oh, how about let's integrate the one variable, make it a two-dimensional variable. You kind of feel more comfortable. Hey, 2D, I may have a software computer, I can solve it. I say, how about 1D? You say, yeah, I like it. It's ODE, it's even simple. Then everybody seems to stop there. You're looking at all the boundary layer integral equation, the integral become ODE equation. Why didn't you or didn't I ask all our teacher, if you want to simplify from 3D to 2D, 2D to 1D, how about 1D, ODE, get it to algebraic equation? What's wrong with that? All right? So this is what I'm going to do after I think about it. The simplest way is solving algebraic equation rather than ODE. And so we try to do it. But of course, every level of the simplification, your solution becomes more approximate, rougher and rougher and rougher. But you gain time. And that's why I said, if you want to do consultant, everybody call me and say, can you do consultant for me? And without hesitation, I have a confidence, yes, I can do consulting for you. I don't even ask how long you want me to do a consultant, because if you want me a one-year consultant, I have a one-year solution. If you want me a 1 week, I have a 1 week. You want to say 1 day, I got a 1 day solution for you. And you know it, you get what you pay for it. So the solution is going to be much simpler and simpler. But sometimes you see, why you call troubleshooter comes in and say, we got a problem here, what do you think it could be? He's guessing, but he using his knowledge to to have a logical estimate of what is going to go wrong. And just pinpoint, maybe you got to open your duct a little bit more, will kill it. It's done, and the solution is done. And that is exactly the same thing. I'm making a simple estimate there. I already know what's happening in my boundary layer. Then all you are cranking out of your system, I say, I just want to see the detail of your numerical value. Otherwise, phenomenal-wise, I already understand. Okay? So we are going to go to the basic equations. And to do it, as I propose, let's sort of look like a dimensional analysis. But the dimensional analysis is that you just pull the variable, you put the dimension in there. There is no law governing the conservation of mass or the conservation of momentum. So the best way to do it is a dimensional analysis, put it into your governing law, then you get additional information out of it. So in order to do it, I'm going to make everything dimensionless. Now, if I make it dimensionless, my argument cannot be easily arranged. So what I want to do is that all, because I'm looking for the algebraic equation. So if I want to get those partial derivative or the derivative to have some magnitude I can pin down, I think the best way to do it, to make your variable change about 1 as a maximum and change from 0 to 1, then you know the derivative will be like a 1. Okay? So that is the basic idea. And that is my idea that as written in my thesis. And many people is smarter than me, for sure, Pronto. You know it, Pronto looking at the momentum equation say, just like a 1, just like a delta, just like a 1, just like a delta, and he did it. All right? So simple. That was Pronto, not me. And I have to be more careful. I got to make a dimensionless, looking at the desk, then I come out and say, oh, I know. So my answer, check with Pronto. But on the other hand, Pronto did not do it for the turbulence. Pronto did not do it in a very complicated equation. So with my procedure set up, I can estimate your mixing turbulent boundary layer, your, all the melting that I did in my thesis. I can do it, all right? So even though a little bit kind of tedious, kind of overdone it, but I have a reason for it, okay? So what I suggest to do is take now without the star, everything capital is a mean and it's dimensional, okay? Now I'm going to divide whatever the reference velocity that I know, for example, in the boundary layer where the flow comes in here is u infinity. So I'm going to make a divide by that one and I call small u. Now it's not a fluctuation, it's a dimensionless now, okay? So it's certainly is 1 because I know the boundary layer outside will be maximum. It will be on the plate, it will be 0, so I know it's a change from 0 to 1, okay? Now on the V side of it, last time we talked about it, we don't know how much the turbulent boundary layer created here is going to kick out the V velocity. When I say kick out here, I assume you intuitively feel that way. Maybe you argue with me that why you say go out, why do you, V don't go down, and then we have a discussion to do, right? But everyone knows that you have this much of the rectangular velocity profile comes in. Coming here, you have a profile reduce it in the u direction. So where the mass conservation got to go out, it cannot go through the plate, all right? So you must go up in that way. So how much it is kicking out, we do not know. So we give it a triangular delta as a fraction of a horizontal velocity to represent that quantity. We don't know it, but we just said that quantity must be such making this small v order 1. And of course, on the plate, v is 0. So I know it's going to be changed from 0 to 1. All right? So I set it up right. Now the y side, which is the boundary layer, is the boundary layer here. If I am estimating the outside layer, I'm going to using Kronecker delta without the subscript I. If I'm estimating where the maximum fluctuation will be, I'm going to call the inside layer, I'm going to call delta I. All right? So now I can set it up almost about the same time, except just the notation difference there. Now you said, how can you do it? You are going to look out the layer in the layer there. I said, well, I set it up, then I'm going to reason with that. which term is most important, and that is going to dictate my inside and my outside behavior, all right? Okay, now X, obviously I can divide by L, no problem, because it's changed from here to where that location, so X will change from 0 to where I'm looking at will be 1. Now, with the Reynolds stress now come into picture, in the two-dimensional one, after you derive your homework, you can write out your two-dimensional equation looks like what. I'm going to divide by U square, and U in this case, of course, is much higher than my fluctuation as I already denoted here, or if you're looking at this, certainly U has this quantity fluctuating maybe, let's say 10%, or maybe even 20%, 30% can be. But anyway, it's smaller. So since I have a two velocity quantity there, I'm going to put the, instead of delta or Kronecker delta, I'm going to using I. Again, it's a fraction of the mean kind of inertial force or the kinetic energy there. So I'm going to using I square to match with the U square there. So I, as I said it last time, sort of like a turbulent intensity. Intensity is say that how much you fluctuate compared with your mean flow. Okay, so in that way, again, I do not know what is the I square is. Okay, now you may want to ask me that how come you keep introducing those unknown? It kind of bothers me that you don't know what you wanted. I said, you see, that is the way I'm approaching to get algebraic equation. I set something in a general quantity I do not know, but I set it such that my variable is all changed from 0 to 1. So once I plug in there, all my derivative, I'm going to call it 1. And what's left, triangular delta, Kronecker delta, I, that is going to be my variable, and that is what I'm looking for. If I know that one, you see, I already solved my problem. So that is the algebra variable I'm after it. Okay? So you know that. And the P, I'm going to normalize by the rho U square, just like a Bernoulli quantity, just balance each other, so I'm going to take it. Okay, so now I'm partially in business now. I can work on it. So by taking a two-dimensional ensemble average Navier-Stokes equation, make it dimensionless as I outlined, U divided by U infinity, V divided by delta U, Y divided by delta L, X divided by L, and so forth, okay? Now I got this chunk of equation here. Let me see if I can, no, I cannot, that's a little bit too long. Okay, now the first equation is a continuing equation. The second equation is the momentum in X directions, because I'm assuming the flow as a whole is a steady, okay? Fluctuating part is certainly unsteady, but we already take the ensemble average. It's a two-dimensional steady averaging turbulent flow there, so I have only U and the V part there, P part there, this viscous stress there, and then I have a Reynolds stress over there. Now remember, I talk about Reynolds stress is like what? In the jogging, we are throwing a baseball or throwing something over, I say I pick up some gravel, stone, throw at you. So that is that kind of the stress there, okay? Now, last time we did look at this basic equation there. Continuous equation is very simple, so let's look at it first. Continuous equation tell us, now all my derivative I'm going to right away claim as 1, okay? You know how Prandtl did it. Prandtl just did it the dimensional part of the equation, say U is 1, X is 1. I was really confused. Gee, Prandtl is so smart. Apple and orange, he knows that how they equal. You see, that U is a velocity, X is a length, and then he called that U is 1, and X is also 1, and he knows how to do it. Now, in my more systematic way, conservative way, now I said, you see, the way I set up dimensionless, I change from 0 to 1, so I know that the derivative must be 1. Obviously, upper side is 1, lower side is 1, right? Now, you look at the V and the Y here. in the original equation, Pronto just look at V, he know that this is smaller than this, so he called delta. And he know the boundary layer is thinner than the length there, he called delta. But again, he knows that the orange must be the same size as the apple. He just said this is delta, all right? But in our more systematic way, now we know that this derivative is 1, and now since they must balance out, so you can see the delta, triangle delta over the Kronecker delta must be 1. Otherwise, if it is big, then you throw the first term away. If it is small, you throw your own term away, then it is not satisfactory. Yes?
It seems like I understand what that's doing, but it seems like somewhere you lost track of sine, plus minus.
Oh, yeah. We are talking about only the magnitude.
Okay.
And besides, all of this fraction we're talking about, delta and delta, that is all positive, right? Because we, so we.
I'm just thinking if you want the continuity equation to come out to 0,
oh, yeah.
If derivatives go to 1, you have 1 plus delta.
That's right.
Equals 0.
That's right. And obviously, let's see, the u side, partial u, partial x, with a, let's say very close here, what you got? Let's say 10 meters per second. By the time you got here, it got 7 meters per second. You slow down, right? Because of another. So with respect to positive x, partial u, partial x is negative, right? But we are estimate negative in what order? It's order 1. So we don't care that is the negative or positive, all right? And of course, v, you know, at 0 here, increasing here, so y increase, v increase. So partial v, partial y is positive, partial u, partial x is negative, then you know it will cancel out, right? But as far as the magnitude goes, that we cannot let this quantity to be one, either very big or very small. For example, if a triangle delta is much, much bigger than the Kronecker delta, then you say this term with a very large value times 1, and this you call 1, then of course 1 is not important, then you know that is not a satisfactory solution. So you can say that for the flow to remain two-dimensional, I got to have a Boston stay there. So that leads you to the conclusion, this delta divided by delta got to be equal, or equal in order. I'm not talking about very precise, okay? So by that one, that. So now you see, this is my estimate, and this is my not a 3D solution, not 2D solution, not a 1D solution. This is my algebraic solution. Okay, I reduce all the way down to this solution. Now, is that so simple? Looks like not important to me. It's very important. Now I know that if this boundary layer thickness is 10% of this length, then I know my B velocity is 10% of a horizontal velocity. You see, without this argument, I can never be able to say that. So if you have a high Reynolds number flow, the turbulence going on there, but the boundary is so thin, then you see, I know the B velocity is also very small. So right away, you have a physical concept of what is going on in the turbulent boundary. Okay, now if a continuity equation can give you that one, you'll be even much happier the momentum equation can give you. Okay, so let's look at the momentum equation. Okay, of course, I already said it here, these three equations cannot handle all the turbulent information. You see, I said that we want to estimate, and we must base on something. These three equations is incomplete. In what sense? Three equations, I can handle only three variables, mathematically speaking. I can handle U, V, P. How about the Reynolds stress? It's not there. So eventually, I got to go and dig out something else. But before we dig it out there, just with this equation, at least we can agree on, we are looking at the turbulent, don't we? So we are going to say that the turbulent term, which is the Reynolds stress term, got to be participating variable. So that means among the many terms, convection term, pressure term, viscous term, turbulent term, you are right away, you said, I got to keep my turbulent term. Otherwise, I don't have anything to speak of the turbulent. So turbulent got to stay, okay? So now we agree in logical way, turbulent got to stay. Now, if you're looking at the outer layer, if I go with the outer layer, flow is here. Do you think out here, viscosity is that important? Yeah. Flow is here. Do you think out here, viscosity is that important? Or the convection inertia force is more important? Suppose I have a flat plate here and the pressure gradient is zero. So we take the pressure gradient out, okay? So by looking at that, your physical intuition is going to compare, this is the inertia force. You see, time rate change the momentum, which is the inertia force. This is the pressure. But if it's a flat plate, you have no pressure gradient, so you really want, you can keep it if there's a pressure gradient. Yeah. Now, this is the viscous force, all right? So you have a choice by saying that this turbulent term must balance by what? You can say balance by viscosity, balance by pressure force, balance by the inertia force, and I say pick the one you like most and the most physically logical. Looks like an inertia force, wasn't it? That the total boundary layer as you're looking at this, right? Yes, you do say that. Are you saying that the totally viscous force is not there? I didn't say that. I just say which one you think is more important, all right? So certainly the inertia force, because you do know it, you change. So inertia force is slowing down, right? So by saying that, now let's see what we get out of it here. We already, from the continuity equation, we know the delta, triangle delta, Kronecker delta is 1. So we are going to call this 1. We are going to call this as 1. Okay? So the inertia force side of it, you can make a conclusion they are what? They are 1. Because I made the dimensionless variable all change from 0 to 1, or the 1 in quantity. Derivative is most logically to be 1. So I'm going to call all this side is to be like a 1. Okay, now if I want to be 1, you're looking at this. I have a Reynolds stress over the y, so I'm going to call it 1, all right? UU over x, I'm going to call 1, but I have a smaller quantity delta there, right? Now you can see the I square over delta is there. So for turbulent to exist to balance the inertia force, I got to have a I square over delta is equal to 1, okay? So now you can see, just by looking at that, which is the conclusion I was drawing here, delta must be equal to I square, okay? Or I said 1 is equal to I square over the delta, which is come from by saying this term must be equal to the inertia term, all right? So I'm not doing any guessing game, just kind of reason it out by myself, which one is most likely. So it's the inertia force. Now, by saying that, what is the I square? Remember, it's a turbulent intensity. Okay, it's a turbulent intensity. So if the boundary layer is very thin, which the delta is very thin, your turbulent intensity is low. Okay, and when boundary layer is thick, your turbulent intensity is high. But you say, no, that don't seem to be right. Turbulent boundary layer thin is created by the high Reynolds number. So boundary layer very thin. High Reynolds number fluctuation is very big. But I say, well, it's dimensionless, you see? It's a fluctuation divided by, looking at this, this I is related to this U, all right? So to create a small boundary layer here, you need a very high Reynolds number. That means high velocity. So your fluctuation compared with that inertia force is a small percentage in the thin there. But it doesn't mean that the absolute value of a fluctuation is smaller than when you have a lower Reynolds number turbulent of a fluctuation here. So you can see right away, if a turbulent occurs, boundary layer is so thick, it's a low Reynolds number, the fluctuating quantity compared with the mean flow is a higher percentage. All right? And when you have very high Reynolds number here, high velocity here, boundary very thin, and the fluctuation even may be large, but compared with your mean flow, is small. That's a very interesting concept there, okay? So that actually tell me a lot. When I was a graduate student, I never realized that. Okay? Now I know it. Now I know it. Okay? Okay, now we can do also another argument. Instead of arguing that from this layer to this layer, because I take you to looking at the overall boundary layer, say that all of this boundary layer fluctuating here compared with the turbulent, what is more likely? You say inertial force. Now I said, let's looking at the very thin layer here, which is turbulent fluctuating a lot. All right? It's very close to the wall. All right? And the influence of the wall is there. So what would you prefer to look at it? If you say it's a flat plate, no pressure gradient, if you equate that one to the inertial force again, then you're talking about the same thing. Right? So the only other opportunity you can look at is that it looks like this very near wall layer there, viscosity can be important. When I argue, say that let's take an inertial force, you may be suspicious of why viscosity gets thrown out. I say, here is your opportunity to say that the viscosity can be important, so let's make it viscosity important, and of course, most likely will be very close to the wall. So if you equate this term to this term, and now, of course, the inner layer I'm talking about, I want to put a subscript I in there to denote I'm looking at the a little bit inside layer there. So if I equal this one to this one, you can see I have a delta and the data I can cancel. So you can see the quantity I'll be looking at is 1 over Reynolds number delta I square and the turbulent intensity divided by I. Okay? And I can cancel one of this. So now you can see my inner layer thickness is inverse proportional to Reynolds number and the turbulent intensity. Very interesting. Very, very interesting. So you know it, the inside layer, how this behave. How this inside layer is depending on, it's inverse, not the square root of Reynolds number like you have in the Brazier's flow, in the boundary layer thickness. It's inverse Reynolds number. So if your velocity increasing by 10 times, you go reduce by 1/10 and so forth. Okay? Okay, so now we have a very interesting situation here. You see, my outer layer is a function of turbulent intensity. My inner layer is inverse of this one. So now you see I get a connection. I get a connections that the inside layer, if I plug this one in, so then you see the outside layer thickness and the inside layer thickness is going to all connect. In addition, you already know it from the continuity equation, the boundary layer thickness and the U being a fraction of the outside velocity is this. So I can conclude, I got this, delta is I square is equal to this delta. And if I want it, I can bring this one in. Okay? So now I got that relation here. Okay? Yes?
Okay, so with that definition of the inner layer, you increase the Reynolds number, how is that going to affect? Okay, so it's 1 over I squared times Reynolds number. But increasing the Reynolds number, how is that going to affect turbulent intensity? I don't know.
Yeah, so we got to go and find out, unless, you see, all of this relation is fine. It's come from the conservation law, because we go to the equation, dig it out. But as I said, this three equations is incomplete. You see? We don't have a governing equation on the turbulent quantity to go at. Now, if we want to do that one, then you got to go and do your homework, and then we got to look at all those messy equations there, all right? Now, to make a quick estimate, I'm going to search to see if there is some kind of data available for me to borrow it in a very simple way And then it's dawned to me that, everything is so clear. Okay, so let's move on. And then your question of intensity being a function of what? We'll see that. Okay, so we'll see that. But before we do that, we only use two equations, continuity equation and momentum equation, twice. One for outer layer, one for inside layer. And you know you find something different. Because by physically saying that the inside viscosity and turbulence is important, the overall layer outside, inertial force, and the turbulence is important. Okay? So by just agreement, we get that result. Now, how about the third equations? We got to look at the third equation here. Actually, third equation here, let me see. Okay. Also very interesting. It's very revealing, too. This side is all 1, because this is 1, this is 1, this is 1, this is 1, this is 1. Okay? Now, we already say that delta I, that must be equal to that. So you can take this quantity, and that is 1. And you can say this has an extra there. So this will be like that one, so that will be like that. However, you're looking at the partial P, partial Y, is 1 divided by delta, triangular delta, and Kronecker delta. And if a partial P, partial Y, you think it like a 1, and divide by the small quantity, boom, that is the most dominant term. This is the most dominant term of all the deaths. That means that you say throw all of them away, right? Just like in your Pronto Bandelier argument, right? So you all the viscous term not important. So remember in your momentum equation, Y in the Bandelier approximation laminar flow, what do you get? Partial P, partial Y equals 0, right? So we did it here. By knowing that the delta quantity or the turbulent intensity quantity is always less than 1, can be small, then by just saying that one, you know it, you get the conclusions that this quantity is going to be much, much larger than that, because you already have that in there. So you can see the momentum equation, the third momentum equation just reduced to partial P, partial Y equals 0. Okay, so what does that mean? It tells us the pressure inside the turbulent boundary layer is also independent of Y, just like a laminar boundary layer, approximately, right? So you see all three equations give us some information. Sketchy, a little bit incomplete, a little bit rough, but we got a lot of a physical understanding out of it. Okay, so the next thing we have to do is that, okay, before we finish, what else you can do? What else you can do? Because now you are, Ken may say, well, Professor Chen, you just made all this conclusion, so what? We don't know any one of those. But I'm going to tell you, say, suppose I know one of it, then I clean up everything, right? Because they are all connected, all right? So let's see how I dig this one. Of course, I keep saying continuity equation, two momentum equations are incomplete. So I got to borrow something. But before I borrow it, let's look at this. Because this is my doing, okay? There's no other textbook or anyone doing that. I said, I know I'm incomplete, so I keep flipping all the books, selecting and undergraduate book. Just about every book, even the undergraduate book, they will give me a friction coefficient measurement. You know the Fourier chart, CF versus Reynolds number, they have a curve there. And I said, what is this CF? All right? So let's look at that CF. CF is a shear stress made dimensionless by rho u squared. Some of them divide by another half there, okay? But it doesn't matter. So let's say, right, what is a tau W? Tau W is mu partial U partial Y. Evaluate at the wall. Then I say, it's near the wall is what we use for the friction coefficient. But my inner layer thickness should be the one used for my estimate. Remember that the velocity profile come down like this and then go like this. So you see, to making an estimate of this quantity, I'm going to using an inner variable, the y thickness, in there. So I'm going to make a partial u, partial y with a delta I in there. All right? So now if I do that, now all of this variable, the derivative now I can claim to be 1. Because again, that's according to my rule, make it like roughly change from 0 to 1 and so forth. So now I got this of order 1. So now I know my CF is delta I. Delta I over Reynolds now, because I have here kinematic viscosity, the length there. So now all of a sudden now I find friction coefficients by order magnitude is my inner layer, inverse proportional to my inner layer thickness and the Reynolds number. All right? And of course, at the time I found it, I didn't know what that really gave me. But now I'm going to approve myself. Gee, you did something good. You see? Now I got all of them connected now. Now I can have all in one solution. CF is I square intensity is equal to delta. Fraction of a V kicking is delta, which is my boundary thickness, order magnitude, is inverse to the delta I Reynolds number. So you see, if I can borrow any friction coefficient chart that you measure, I get all of this understand. How much the we get kick out, how much the outside thickness, how much the inner thickness, and what is doing. Okay? So before I let you go there, let's quickly look at this. I think you've at least I am very happy with what I got here. I don't know how happy you will be, unless you are not so negative happy. You can see my CF is here, and the Reynolds number is here. You can go and find smooth plate in there, okay? And the turbulence is here. This is laminar transition goes up, go there. So let me take a turbulent part of here. I have a CF is 0.03, roughly Reynolds number raised to minus 1/5 power, okay? So if I plug that one in, now you see I got a solution. This is an algebraic solution, not 3D, not 2D, not 1D. I have an algebraic solution of all of this get cleaned up here. I just plug in CF is equal to this equation that I got over here, which is in there. So now that is my solution. So now, let's not, maybe next time we're looking at a little bit more here. You see here, this is a 10 to the minus, this is 10 to the minus 3, 10 to the, yeah, 10 to the minus 3, 10 to the minus 2. So this is like a 0.03, all right? 0.003. So you can see, giving a Reynolds number here, looking at the CF, and you know the CF is a turbulent intensity. So you're looking at the G, my boundary layer, if a Reynolds number go up from the experiment, I know, looking at the CF coefficient, it didn't mean anything to me, just the friction coefficients. Now, I'm looking at the CF, that is my turbulent intensity. So if it is a 0.02, I say 2% turbulent intensity. If it's a 0.05, I say 5% turbulent intensity. To me, it's very, very comfortable. I know it. If you give me a flow here and say measurement here, I have CF that one, then I know how much you are fluctuating compared with the mean flow. You see? So now CF means more to you than any undergraduate student looking at the CF chart. Okay? Now you can go and compare all of this. And now, let me just quickly conclude, then we'll call it today. You can see now I found the inner layer. If I'm using the formula that I get, it grows like a L to the 1/5 power. The outer layer grows like a L to the 4/5 power. So here is my short conclusion here. Now I know why you need the inner law and the outer law, because the inside layer grows x to the 1/5 power. The outer layer grow like x to the 4/5 power. They are growing at a different rate. So of course, you want to have a similarity solution piled up on each one of them. They will never match. So my conclusion is that now I have a reason why the similarized solution does not exist for turbulent boundary layer, why I need a study inner law, I need a study outer law, all the dimensionless variable I got to create for inner law, outer law, they got to be all different. So I can go and talk to all my friends, say, you're so happy I can explain all of this, you'll never be able to tell me now I got it. Okay, so even though I kind of go a little bit slower in here, but I think I want to give you the basic essence of my thinking, which is go a step simpler, cruel, but I dig out something very quick here. So I don't want to solve 3D, I don't want to solve 2D, I don't want to solve 1D, I want to solve algebraic equation. That is what the Plantel's original idea of the order magnitude analysis. I just put it in a better context, easier way for everyone to understand. For those smart guys, they can just go G.I. Taylor, I know this Professor John Lundy, he said, I expect this to be this, I expect this to be this. I said, gee, you tell me that, how I can expect? I don't have anything to base. So the very authoritative people, they will know what they are looking at. But for us, we know a little bit of physical intuition, but let's go step at a time. We can dig out lots of results this way. Okay, so I'll stop here. Next time we'll continue. There will be more interesting results coming out of this order magnitude analysis.